flying, if you haven't flown, it's a beautiful thing. When you talk to pilots, about 50% of them tell you that their first touch point with aviation was Microsoft Flight Simulator. The more people get to touch that and maybe fall in love with it, I mean, I think we would be so humbled if we achieve just a little bit of that. My name is Jörg Neumann. I am the head of Microsoft Flight Simulator at Microsoft. Flight Simulator was one of the very, very first pieces of software the company published. It predates Office, it predates Windows. It has a very special place in the history of the company. It was groundbreaking. It stressed out PCs then. It's kind of a benchmark of what's possible. And that puts you in a position where you have to do something special. You can't just make another version every year or something like that, because it really doesn't add anything to the substance.
I just got a new PC at that time. It was actually my first PC. I had nothing to play, so I just started hacking around and testing and programming. And then I started just making the games I wanted to play. At some point I found out that it's more fun to make them than to play them. I'm Sebastian Block, CEO of Sobo Studio. I'm one of the lead engineers on Microsoft Flight Simulator.
For me, the fascination with airplanes started much earlier as a kid, but then seeing that realized in a computer game was sort of falling in love all over again with planes. Flying is a very intrinsic human dream. Seeing that on a PC, even as early as 79 or then for Microsoft 82, I think was eye-opening what can be achieved. The dream that goes all the way back to the beginning of the franchise, can we get the planet to a much, much greater level of detail? And the answer was probably. The dream for aviators has always been to be able to use VFR. VFR stands for visual flight rules. You look outside the window and lo and behold, it looks exactly like the real world. You need a highly accurate model of the Earth in order to do that. I found this company now called Black Shark AI. And they are machine learning experts. They had done this for a while. I saw their prototype and it was doing similar things to what we are trying to achieve. I talked to the Bing Maps team, which is a wonderful resource we have at Microsoft, and they have tons of data. Satellite imagery, aerial imagery, essentially photographs of the planet at high resolution. So the raw materials were there. But when you look at Bing Maps, it's not really needing a high frame rate. That's not really the experience, right? It's very much a map app. In our case, you need to run at minimal at 30 frames a second, and our gaming effort is worldwide. So you need to run at 30 frames a second worldwide, which basically means you need to get that 2.5 petabytes to everyone, wherever they sit. As long as they have internet, you need to be able to get the data. I talked to some trusted developers, in this case, Sobo Studios.
We actually started working with Microsoft way before Microsoft Flight Simulator started. One of the projects we were working on HoloLens, was representing the planet, scanning and rendering and reconstructing. And there was really a lot of technical background which really led to the idea.
They have a wonderful engine that allows us to render and stream large amounts of data, and it's very pretty.
You have all that data, but is it small enough to fit on an end-user computer? Very quickly you find out it is not. The technology needed is something which can store huge, which can process huge, but which can deliver small to a lot of people all around the globe. And that's where Azure kicked in, and it really helped us make sure we could deliver everything to a huge amount of users at the same time. It just worked.
And so early prototypes already showed that we could do a very high resolution model of Seattle that looked near perfect. And then we tried the Grand Canyon because we wanted to see sort of an expansive natural landscape. And that was successful. I basically said, I think we can do this.
The idea of the digital twin is try to build a one-to-one copy of the planet, a digital copy. That is not in 3D, but I would say maybe in 4D, right? That is really moving through time like the real planet. It's important as a simulation to be as close as possible to reality.
So we kept working ourselves outward and added more and more. And at some point, we had the entire planet at high resolution. We have 37,000 airports, 2 billion buildings, 2 trillion trees. But that's not enough either, because we are flying planes in flight zone. And the thing that makes flying so fascinating is no flight's the same because of the atmosphere. Full day and night cycle, full season cycle, a very detailed weather model. The sun, the moon is fully realized and simulated. Getting a real great atmospheric simulation was paramount to making this successful. One looks at the complexity of all this and the data set and one says, how does this work? How does this run on a regular computer? And it does because of the Microsoft tech stack.
It was really a conjunction of all these technologies, storage, source data, delivery, that came together.
Microsoft has built an incredible amount of infrastructure with data centers across the planet. All the infrastructure around that enables us to get the data to the people. We had never thought about the cloud that way, but it totally worked. There is no more hard definition of what a platform is. Every platform does punch above its weight class because you can get a lot more data than you could ever store. So essentially just becoming an endpoint. More and more of the processing will be cloud-based, and it's a really good thing. We thought that the physical box that we're working on is the limiter, that the CPU and the GPU and the amount of storage you have is the determiner of what you can achieve, and that is no longer so.
It's orders of magnitudes bigger of anything that we've ever thought of. I mean, our people working on Azure, it's not a huge team, right? So I think the tools are very efficient. Without that, we wouldn't have been able to do anything of it.
You don't have to invent a bunch of technology. You can plug yourself into the technology stack that we had, which I think it's going to take gaming to definitely to a new level. You have to keep your mind free and let it sort of explore a little bit what is possible. Set your mind to what is important to you, and you can do it.